Hi, I'm your host, Steve Harvey, and I got a good one for you today. Oh, no, that's Family Feud, isn't it? Oh, yeah, this is what... See, I have absolutely no idea what's going on today, so please do not hold me responsible for anything that may transpire this morning. But I do want to say good morning and welcome. If you are visiting New Hope today, you are a guest today, thank you for coming. I'm apologizing now. This is not the way we normally do church. We don't usually have a Wheel of Fortune all right in here, but this is a bit unusual. This is planned by other folks in the church. It's Pastor Appreciation Month, Pastor Appreciation Sunday. So this whole group up here, all right, is the pastoral staff at New Hope, and they're going to be honored or shamed or something today, all right? And so thank you for coming and for being a part of it. Highlight just a couple of things and prayer requests, and then we'll have our offering, and then I am sitting down, okay? So... If you are visiting with us, there are some cards in the pew. I would love for you to fill one out, drop it in the offering bag, and next week through the mail, we'll send you information we hope will be very, very helpful for you. Christmas choir, you are going to learn two songs this year. Not going to be as extensive. We're doing some things different for Christmas because Easter's coming really fast after Christmas. So Christmas choir is going to start November. It's coming earlier this year. Okay, Easter, you know, kind of moves. It fluctuates. So it's in March, not April. So, all right. So, Christmas choir. If you want to sing in it, November the 1st is the first choir practice. All right. Africa pledges, 1040i. Those need to be in by the end of the month, and you know who I'm talking to. New Hope Marriage Retreat, November 13th, 14th, and 15th. Information out in the pavilion, all right, at the Welcome Center. Please stop by and see Nick. Yesterday, the big shoot and the church-wide showing of Woodlawn, two great events, both went really, really well. And if you haven't seen Woodlawn, you'll want to take somebody and go see it. It is an exceptionally good movie. A few prayer requests. Dorothy Levinson, we shared with you last Sunday. She went home to be with the Lord the preceding week. Her services are this Saturday at 10 o'clock right here at New Hope, and you are welcome to come. She was part of our church family. Brandy Walker has had some more tests, and they are exploring some other options, so please continue to pray for Brandy Walker. She has the tumor that is involved with her optical nerve behind her left eye. Barry Perlstein and his family, the diagnosis of their one-month-old grandson with cystic fibrosis. Kathy Little had surgery on Friday, had a mass in her stomach, didn't know what it was. They now know it's benign, and it has been removed, and we are grateful for that. She may be going home this afternoon. Chick Passarella, who normally is either on stage or sitting right over here, he is lost today. He is sitting back there in front of the sound booth, all right? So he just... couldn't find his way, but anyway, he's here, but he's having surgery on Thursday, hernia surgery, so please be praying for him and for his recovery. Those are the updates. There's other things in the bulletin. Please take the opportunity to read it. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Gentlemen, would you come, please? Join with me as we pray. Our Father, we want to thank you for the beauty of this day and the privilege that we have to share in it. Thank you for some more rain. We're looking forward to a whole lot more over the next several months. But thank you for what we got last night. Father, we're grateful for your sufficiency in our lives as we face the challenges of the week. You know what we've been through this last week, and you met our every need that we trusted to you. And you know what we're going to face this coming week. And so we say thanks in advance for your goodness to us. This world, the scripture says, will treat us horribly. In this world, you told us we will have trouble. But we have the sufficiency of Jesus Christ in us to get us through the challenges of this world. And we say thanks. We trust you for the needs that we've already spoken about today and those other concerns in people's hearts that are very personal to them. Thank you, Father, that you have ears that hear every one of our prayers. And we say thanks for the privilege of giving and sharing to you. It's a tribute to our belief that you are sufficient to meet our needs. It is a tribute that we believe that your Son, Jesus Christ, was raised from the dead. So thank you for this way in which we express our dependence upon you. And we do all of this in the incredible, marvelous, matchless name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, Welcome to New Hope's Pastor Appreciation Day and Wheel of Fortune. And now here's your co-host, Pat Sajak and Vanna White.
To be here this morning. You know, Vanna and I have been doing this gig for over 30 years, and we've never been to a church before, so this is a first. And it's also a first that we're here in Clovis, California. But we're excited to be here with you today to celebrate Pastor Appreciation Day at New Hope. And Vanna, I couldn't help but notice this prize wheel. You know, ours is flat, and this is vertical. That must have been a real challenge for someone to make. I sure would like to meet that person.
Well, Pat, I think I can probably arrange that, actually. But being vertical isn't the only change on the wheel. As you can tell, we've replaced our money prizes with movie titles, which our character today is going to be movie. That's our category, movie titles. So it's going to be changing up a little bit and a little bit challenging for these pastors, but I know they can do it. What we're going to ask them to do is they're going to come up and spin, and on the movie title that they land on, they're going to have to preach on a parable that deals with the subject matter of the movie. Oh, my goodness. I'm getting kind of a little heart palpitations for them right now. But we all love each other here at New Hope. I hear this is a closed church, so there'll be grace if they... Yeah. So we're just going to have to see how that works. But... you know, Jesus always told his stories in parables. They were very powerful. They were direct, short, and sweet, and to the point. So this isn't a sermon for each of you. You only get 5 minutes.
5 minutes?
5 minutes.
For all of them?
For each one, they only get 5 minutes.
Even for the senior pastor?
Absolutely. And he's got to share the stage a little bit today, which is a little bit.
Oh, my goodness.
So we'll see how that works. But anyway, 5 minutes to get direct, to the point, okay? So it's going to be a lot of fun.
Thank you, Vanna. Now, not only will the pastors each be able to spin the wheel to see which movie title they're going to preach on, they're also going to have an opportunity to win a prize. As you'll notice, there's a prize space on the wheel. So, Vanna, tell us, what kind of prizes will our contestants be eligible to win today?
Well, Pat, you know our production staff always comes ahead of when we come to a city, and they kind of find out what people like around here. So we try to accommodate the prizes to fit with the New Hope congregation. So we heard that they do a lot of cooking, a lot of home cooking here. And so for chefs, we have some custom-made cutting boards out of pure maple. And what's that other? Walnut. Okay. Yeah. I should have known that. Darn. And then we've got a birdhouse, which is really fun because we see it's so beautiful out here in Clovis. We have a Christian wall hanging. And there's a cigar lounge. I know. I don't know if you guys in the back can see that, but it's actually a little lounge chair, and there's three cigars laying on. But I hear when pastors do it, it's called holy smokes, and so then it's kind of okay. Yeah. They can make everything seem okay, right? Okay.
All right. Well, we're just about ready to fire up the wheel, but before we do, we want to welcome to the stage now one of New Hope's, I hear, most favorite entertainers and worship leaders, Tim Kepler. So, Tim, come on out.
But you know what I forgot to do, Pat?
You forgot something?
I did. We need to practice. How many people have seen Wheel of Fortune? Raise your hand. Okay. You know how integral the audience participation is, okay? So when we say, come on up, do you want to play? You're supposed to say, Wheel of Fortune. So let's practice. Okay, come on up. We're going to play
Wheel of Fortune.
Woo-woo. I like that. You guys are like good. All right. Now, you know our pastors are a little bit nervous because they're looking there thinking, oh my gosh, what am I going to land on? What am I going to talk about? So we want to encourage them. And so when they're spinning, we're going to clap. Okay? So just watch me. When I clap, you clap. Okay? I do this for a living. It's really good. It tones your arms. You know, it'll be fun. Okay. All right. I think we're ready now.
Ready to start?
Yeah. Sorry.
All right. We're ready or not. Let's take off. So Vanna, if you'll take your place at the wheel. Oh, boy.
She's going to be hard to live with after this.
Not that Pat and Van have a relationship. Oh, boy. All right. Okay, Gene, like it or not, you're number one. So, dude, come on up. All right, Gene. Well, first I got to ask you a couple questions.
Oh, okay.
Gene, what's your position here at the church?
Associate pastor.
And how many years have you been here?
15.
Excellent. All right. Now, Gene, do you have anyone special here with you in the audience today?
I do.
Who might that be?
I've got several people that are special to me. My wife, Jerry. My daughter, Jennifer, and her husband, Eric. Woo! And all the folks that went shooting with us yesterday.
Absolutely.
Okay. All right. Well, welcome, everyone. I'll try and make them proud. So if you want to step over there with Peggy, we're going to spin from that side.
It's Vanna.
Oh, Vanna.
Vanna. Oh, my gosh. Where do you get good help these days?
Now I'm going to get out of the way. Okay, go for it now.
All right. Woo! Woo! Oh, no, it's... Oh!
That's a chick flick. I don't want
Dan, buy me! Oh, we, and you know what?
I don't want that.
You can do it.
I know. We've kind of stolen another game show that we're letting him preach or pass, okay? You're going to pass. You're going to pass? Okay, all right,
all
right.
Don't,
yeah. Stay by. Okay. All right, no. Okay, okay. All right, so you've got to do it sometime, all right? So somebody has to go. Gene, you go ahead and sit down.
You want that one?
Somebody.
Good luck. Good luck. All right.
All right. So.
Just because you got more gray hair than me doesn't mean you get to go first.
Yeah. Yeah.
This is going to be a rowdy deal, I can tell. All right, Rich Smith, tell us your position and number of years.
I'm the counseling pastor, and I came with the Ashbrook Group at the merger, and that's been about 25 years.
Excellent. And do you have anyone special here in the audience today?
I do. I have my beautiful wife, Regina.
Woo!
Somewhere in here, I may have my son, Ethan.
Okay.
Awesome.
All right.
Okay. Rich, go ahead and take a seat. We're going to give him a little bit of a hint, because some of these guys may not have even seen the movie. And just remind us, because this was back in 1986 that this movie was released. Stand by me. Four very different boys set on a journey to seek the truth. A bookworm, a mentally unstable, a criminal, and a timid, overweight boy. This sounds probably some of the folks that you deal with in your counseling thing. This is how apropos. As their journey moves along, the boys discover not all they perceive as truth is actually the truth. Threatened for exposing the truth with death, the boys have a hard decision to make. Will they do evil for evil? Will they stand firm in their beliefs? Or will they cave? In the end, they decide no one will get the credit. They start promising to say goodbye and see each other the next week in seventh grade. What would Christ do in this moment? How would Christ treat others? How do we live our lives? What would we do for our faith? Okay, so that kind of warms it up for you.
Okay.
Go, 5 minutes.
Just a bit of trivia. Anyone remember the most famous line of that movie? It is, "You want to see a dead person?" And I don't know how that fits here, but... Stand By Me was about four very different young men who came together for an amazing journey. And the Bible talks about a similar transformation in the life of 12 very different individuals who... generally would not even be caught dead together, but because of the compelling love of Jesus Christ, they became a group of individuals that today that we talk about as the Lord's disciples. And the word disciple is a very interesting word in the Greek. It is mathetes, which means a couple of things. It could mean a learner, it could mean one who follows the teacher, or it could mean an imitator of the teacher. And I like that definition the best, that a disciple is one who aspires to imitate the teacher. And that is our calling as believers, is to do the same thing, to be imitators of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the 12 men who became known as the disciples of Jesus Christ were unified in four different ways, and that's what I'm just going to share briefly with you, that they were unified by their mission. And at one point, Jesus calls out the disciples, and he says, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." They were unified in their calling. At one time, as Jesus was preparing to ascend back to the Father, he speaks to the disciples and he says that you will be witnesses of me both in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and the uttermost parts of the world. They were unified in their purpose. At one point when other disciples, other individuals had fallen away because the message of Christ was a little bit hard to live, Jesus asked the disciples and he said, "Are you also going to fall away?" And Simon Peter, the spokesman of the group, says to Jesus, "Of course we won't, Lord, because you're the only one that has the words of truth. Where else would we go?" And then they were unified in their faith. And that as Jesus responds to questions about his authority and who he is and his purpose, he asks the disciples, who do people say that I am? And Peter responds, some say you're Elijah, some say that you're John the Baptist raised from the dead, and a number of other possibilities. And Jesus asks the disciples, he says, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter, again, as a spokesman for the disciples, says, "Lord, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And so 12 men who normally would have nothing in common now are bonded by the love of Jesus Christ. And yes, even though one fell away, another was chosen to replace them. And that's an inspiration to us today, that just as 12 ordinary men changed the world because of their love for Jesus Christ, so you and I as believers have been called to a unified purpose, a unified calling, a unified mission, and a unifying faith in our Lord Jesus.
Woo-hoo! Yeah. Rich, wait a minute.
Nope.
Just as a token of our appreciation, especially since you're the first one, pick a prize. Even though you didn't land on the prize, you still get a little token. You're welcome.
Well done, Rich. Thank you very much. Okay, so what do you think? You did okay? Yes. Somebody had to break the ice, and we appreciate you doing that. Okay, next up.
Oh, I've heard about our production team again. Go ahead.
We've had advance notice of the next guy, haven't we?
We have. He's trouble.
Yeah, trouble.
We can handle it.
Capital T trouble.
Absolutely.
I may just let you do this one entirely then.
Okay. All right. It's Lonnie Rowland.
All right.
Come on up. Yeah. Okay. We'll have you stand over here. Pat, come on over here. We're improvising. Okay. Now, our sources tell you that you don't go by Lonnie around here. You go by Pops. Can we call you Pops?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Okay. All right, Pops.
Pops, before we get started, though, tell us how many years have you been associated
here,
with...
Turn around so the audience can see you.
With the church?
Yes.
Started.
Since the beginning of time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And did you have anyone special in the audience you'd like to recognize?
Everybody.
All right.
Woo!
Well, I am very sure that they are all blessed to have you in this congregation. So thank you.
Well. Oh.
All right.
Pops.
We're going to give this wheel a spin.
Take a hold and go for it. Are you nervous? Yeah. Oh, okay. No. Oh, is it going to get a prize?
It's going to be real close.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh. War room. Okay. Do you want to? Okay. Do you want to preach or pass? You want to preach or pass? It's war room.
War room.
He wants to pass.
You want to pass or you want to preach on prayer?
You want to. You're preaching. Okay. Pops, come sit down. You're going to preach. Right. Okay. All right.
Pops is a little unstable today. Okay. He's struggling a little bit. So here it goes. Let me give me just a minute to chat with him and see what he wants to do. Tell me what you want me to preach.
This is a movie that just came out this year. How many people saw the word? Yes.
Pretty good.
Yes. It's
excellent.
So exciting. So we're going to let Pastor Tim take it.
He's given me a few thoughts real quick right there. Let's see what we can handle here. For those of you who don't know, he's 90. And and he told me a few thoughts in my ear right there about prayer. And here's what Dad would like you to know about prayer. He said, Prayer is talking with God. And he said, I love to talk to God. And the reason I love to talk to God is because God loves me very, very much. And I love God very, very much. I get to share my needs with him. And he shares his promises and his power and his comfort and his encouragement with me. Dad said, I learned about praying for other people from listening to my own mother pray on a creek bank in Oklahoma. And I learned about needing to pray for myself from a foxhole in Germany during World War II. Pop said, you're never too young to pray, and you're never too old to pray. And he said, thank God, because that's all I'm doing these days. There's nothing too big that you can't pray to God about, and there's nothing too small that you can't talk to God about. There's nothing too important, and there's nothing too unimportant that we shouldn't talk to God about. You can pray on your knees, or you can pray standing up. You can pray with your eyes wide open, and he recommends that if you're driving.
Yeah.
And you can pray with your eyes closed. You see, Dad knows that your physical posture is unimportant, but humility of your heart is absolutely necessary. When we are humble enough to admit that we need God and that we are wise enough to trust God, then that's when we win the battles of this life and we get to claim the rewards in the next life. So whether you're in church or you're in your car, or you're at the ocean, or you're on a mountaintop, anywhere and everywhere is an okay place to pray. Even in your closet, like the war room. Here is what God said through Paul about prayer in Philippians 4, 6 and 7. And I've heard my dad quote this verse many, many times. Don't fret and don't be anxious about anything. But in every circumstance of your life, by prayer and petition, with a heart filled with gratitude, make your requests known to the Lord. And God's peace will be yours. So fear nothing, for this peace of God transcends all understanding, and it will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ. Pop, you whispered a lot to me just a moment ago. Amen.
Woo-hoo! Okay.
You can do it.
Okay, Pops. Pick a prize. All right, good deal, good deal.
All right, Pastor Tim, we need you back up here for just a second. We have to spin for Pops for a prize because he didn't have that opportunity. Or wait.
No. We're gonna do Rich.
I did that wrong.
Yeah. It's okay. Yes. Yeah.
I hate to say this, but you're right.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Hey, she's Vanna Wright.
Vanna Wright, okay.
Yeah, give one.
Yes.
All right. Oh, yeah, Rich, you need to come up. I knew somebody had to spin for a prize.
Yes. Yeah. We've already heard from Rich, but he gets a chance to do a prize, right? Okay, so go ahead and spin the wheel. I know. Okay. Oh, you didn't get a prize. Sorry.
Well, thank you for participating. Better luck next time.
Yeah. but you know what? While it's up there on E.T., who wants to preach on E.T.?
It was extra special in my time.
Before
your time.
But I think I got something on
E.T. You do? Oh, my. This is audience participation at its best.
Well, welcome to the stage. And
oh, my gosh.
What's your name?
Robert.
Robert. Okay, well, it's kind of radical. You're just popping out of the crowd. You're courageous.
Yeah, well, these guys don't look like they wanted it, and I think I might have something.
Well, good.
Yeah.
He's been talking to me a little bit, yeah.
Well, we're happy
Did
to have you.
Did you see this movie? It was 33 years ago. How old are you?
Well, how old are you?
56! 56, I'm proud of it! Yeah!
37.
Okay, well, it was 33 years ago, so you were like a little tyke if you saw this.
Yeah, I watched it later on in life.
Oh, yeah. Later.
I watched the reruns on VHS, though.
Oh, yes, okay. Okay, all right. Let me give, for those of you that may have not seen it, let me give you just a little bit warm up. Okay, how many did have seen E.T.? Oh, my gosh, almost everybody. So you know what the movie's about. You don't need any. No? It was about visiting aliens that came in, and all of a sudden, one of the aliens was left behind. We had E.T. phone home, and remember, what was the candy that he loved?
Oh, the Reese's Pieces.
Pieces.
Yeah.
That's when that became, like, the candy, right? Before that, who ate that? You know, it was M&M's. But anyway, so E.T. finds himself in a foreign land, and here's a few scenes to think about. E.T. can heal a bleeding cut. Christ healed a severed ear. E.T. caused objects to fly. Christ commanded Peter to walk on water and turn water to wine. E.T. dies and then miraculously is restored to life. Christ's crucifixion and resurrection. E.T. leaves the boy to return home, the ascension of Christ. And finally, in the closing scenes, E.T. promises he will always be in there, indicating in the boy's head and his heart. And as we know, Christ always lives within us. You know, this is really a weird way to look at movies now. I'm thinking, it's okay to watch these movies, and can you imagine trying to think these parables? But you're going to tell us about a parable, so go for it.
Oh my gosh, 5 minutes. I don't know if I've done anything in 5 minutes. But, hey, do you guys know what E.T. is short for? Well, that's the acronym, but E.T. is short because he's got little legs. You see.
Oh!
Real small. So, hey. So, there's some really good parables in E.T. There's some themes that come out in the movie that are directly correlated with the scripture, I think. Themes like home. You know, E.T. wanted to get home. It wasn't okay for him to stay in a land that was not his own. And I feel like inside of us, there's this beckoning voice, this something, this intuition that says, this world is not our home. That there's something better on the other side. And I think that's why the movie was so successful. Because it reached in and it touched something that was maybe subconscious to all of us. That we don't really belong here. And yet we were placed here, and there's a reason, and I believe that reason is community. I look at some of the ways that Jesus healed people while he was here. I think about the prostitute. I think about the lame, the blind, and the mute. I think about how God even talked to the tax collector. And isn't it funny that in this day and age that whenever the list of sinners are placed out there, tax collectors always right in the midst of all of that stuff. But the cheaters and the liars and the swindlers. And I think that God, coming to earth incarnate, he did this to meet one of our greatest needs. And if I can just maybe settle down for a minute here to share this, because I believe that there's a lie out there floating around. That's the greatest lie in the universe. I think it's the thing that can keep us from God, from eternal life. I think it's the pinnacle of pride. And it's this lie that we hear sometimes from the mouth of someone else. And it's this lie that sometimes boils up from deep within. And the lie is that I need no one. See, I posted on Facebook last week because, not that I knew this was coming, if you guys are buying the show, then I've got some property to sell you. But I trust that you at least consider what each of these people have to say, because before long, we might be burying some of them. And I want to eke out every bit of wisdom I can before they go. But this lie that we don't have need, that we don't have pain, that we don't have sores. And I posted this thing on Facebook that says the first step in healing is recognizing you have a wound. Do you believe that? Because if you don't, then you have subscribed yourself to the greatest lie in the universe, and I want to tell you that it's straight from the pits of hell, because each of us has a need, a very desperate need. And in psychology, they call it love and belonging, and at home, we might call it family, and out in the city, we might call it community, but it's the same thing. That we have this desperate need to be held and to be healed. And it's the reason that E.T., the movie, was successful. My favorite scene as an 11-year-old boy when I watched that was the finger, the long, creepy finger with the bolt, like the red end. And Elliot had just cut his finger on a saw blade as he was rifling through some stuff. And E.T. looked at him and he had compassion. This extraterrestrial looked at him and he had compassion and he said, "Ouch." Right? You remember? And they touched fingers, and it was instantly healed. It was a miracle. And my favorite thing about God is I think about the whole of Scripture and all of creation, and all the way fast-forwarding to today, is that moment where God looks at us and he says, "Ouch." I think about Jesus up in heaven looking down on his creation and being saddened, not angry, saddened by all the things that he sees because of the denial that we have a need. And because of that, we get frustrated, because intuitively we know we have needs. And that causes frustration, and then we get angry, and then we start lashing out at others. And you see things like addiction and other coping mechanisms. And Jesus looked down on that instead of saying, "I got to start over. These people are jacked up." Can I say that, church? These people are messed up. I got to start over. But he didn't do that. God's answer to sin and pain and denial was not to look away, not to abandon us, but to come down and join us in our mess. He saw all that junk that was so terrible, and most of us would look at that and run the other direction. We don't want to be a part of sexual abuse. We don't want to be a part of murder. But God was compassionate, and he joined us in our mess because he saw that we had an ouch. And ladies and gentlemen, friends and family, if we could just get past our pride for 1 minute and recognize that we have an ouch, We can bring that to the Jesus who came and joined us in our mess, and he will heap up our ouches on his shoulder, and he will ask us to follow him in that moment because it's not over. We still have a part to play in that relationship. And he's, if we follow him, we'll see that he will go to the cross, and he will hang his arms up, and for the first time, we can get past ourselves and recognize that Jesus, too, has an ouch. And it's a two-way relationship at that point. And he's asked us also, and lastly and finally, as he departed from this place, to love one another. A new command I give to you. Remember, Jesus healed even his enemy who was coming to take him to the cross, and his buddy cut off that guy's ear. And Jesus said, enough of this. And he placed the ear back on his head and healed him. And we too, we have people that speak against us. We have people that hurt us, that cause us those ouches. Jesus told us to find those people, to be with them, to do what he did and join them in their mess. To be able to look at the neighbor or the person sitting across the pew from you and say, you're a mess. Instead of judging you and instead of giving you advice that was unsolicited, instead of handing you a book and trying to get you to subscribe to this 12-step program, I'm just going to join you in your mess. Is that okay? Can I just cry with you? And in that moment, we let Jesus reach out a finger and say, ouch, I love you. And that's what he's doing.
Good job. I'd hate to be the next one preaching after that.
Yeah. All right.
Nope, no pressure, guys, but woo.
Yes, thank you so much. All right, we'll move along to the next one. And
I think we're down to the church's senior pastor, Tim McLean Rowland.
All right. Do you have anybody here special today?
Oh, absolutely, right here on the front row is my beautiful wife, and right over there on the front row is my wonderful father.
Oh my gosh.
And everybody else.
Yeah, that line was already used.
I learned it from him.
Yeah. Okay, all right. Are you ready to
come? I'm ready.
Okay,
all right. I want prize because there's some really fine stuff.
I know.
The cylindrical objects.
Yeah.
Cylindrical object.
Okay. Pastor Tim, what prize do you want to win? He's the one that calls them holy smokes, all right? All right. That's okay, yeah?
Yeah, go for it.
There is no shame, yeah. Okay. A field of dreams. Are you going to preach or are you going to pass?
Well, I'm going to preach on that, but that's a baseball movie. That is a baseball movie.
Okay.
I want that one.
All right.
I'm not very good at that.
I want that one.
All right. How many have seen, remember Kevin Costner? A Field of Dreams?
Let me get my mind.
Okay. All right. What was the best line? What was the most famous line from that movie? Who knows? Yeah! Okay, I don't think you guys need any prep for this movie. You've already seen it. Okay, Tim, take it away.
Oh, great movie. Let's see what I can Google up here real quick about this. Yeah, you know I love baseball, and this is one of the all-time baseball greats. Ray Kinsella is the key character in this movie, if you remember. And who played that part? Yeah, the love of my wife's life, Kevin Costner. If you go into our workout room, there is a life-size picture of Kevin Costner there. But in that movie, Ray plows under acres upon acres of his life-sustaining corn crop in order to build this baseball field because he heard a voice that said to him, "If you build it, they will come." And this field was going to play host to legendary past baseball greats. The most famous of them is, you remember, Shoeless Joe Jackson. But you see, Ray is faced with this dilemma of holding on to his field of dreams or destroying his crop. And if he destroys his crop, from his perspective, he's going to lose everything that he has, that he owns on this earth. In fact, if I remember correctly, his brother-in-law counsels him with these words, "You're going to lose your farm, pal. You're going to go bankrupt. You're going to default on your loans. Sell now or you'll lose everything." How could you plow under your crop? As the story goes, Ray holds on to his field of dreams at a very high cost of losing all that the world has to offer him. This field of dreams meant everything to Ray. He was willing to sacrifice everything for it. A couple of months ago, I started thinking a lot about dreams, about my dreams. These are not the kind of dreams I have when I'm asleep. These are the kind of dreams that keep you awake at night. The dream of a family, the dream of starting a business, the dream of having kids, the dream of getting married, the dream of publishing a book, the dream of owning a large home, the dream of becoming a missionary, the dream that all your family will love Christ. I grew up in a generation that has been told, if you can dream it, you can have it. I remember in third grade being told, if you want to be president of the United States, you can be. It's possible. You want to be a teacher? You can do it. You want to be a famous actor? Work hard at it and your dreams will come true. With enough work, all your dreams can become reality. It's sort of like the field of dreams. If you build it, they will come. If you dream it, it will happen. And I'll be honest. There have been times I've almost bought into that idea, hook, line, and sinker. I've bought a few books written by Christian authors that said the same thing. I've written out life plans for myself. But in these last couple of months, I've come to affirm something that God's been trying to get me to understand for a long time. And that is, God is not in the dream fulfilling business. And as soon as I say that, God does fulfill dreams. Just not my dreams. God is in the business of fulfilling his dreams. See, this theme runs throughout all of the Bible. God has a plan, a dream, if you will, for every single one of you. I don't care how young or old. I don't care what your educational background is. I don't care what your social status has been. I don't care whether you're an extrovert or an invert. Invert, that's not right. Introvert, thank you. Yeah, I knew there was something there not right. God has a dream I'd speak right English. See, God has a plan for every one of us, every single one of us. And he always fulfills his dream when we let him. Abraham and Sarah dreamed of having lots of kids together. But God had a dream for Abraham and Sarah. And that dream was that they have only one son. And through that one son, God would have an incredible covenant with his people. Moses dreamed of growing up in Pharaoh's court. But God dreamed of sending Moses to the desert for 40 years. And then using Moses to lead his people as far away from Pharaoh's palace as he possibly could. Hannah dreamed of having a large family. But God dreamed of her having a son named Samuel, who would be dedicated to the Lord's service, and he would be the maker of kings. The people of Israel dreamed of a Messiah who would come in power and destroy all of the enemies of Israel. God dreamed of a Messiah who would come in weakness and humility and be crucified on a cross and raised from the dead on a third day. What's the moral of this story? Is that God's dreams for me and God's dreams for you are better than our dreams for ourselves. And God will always fulfill his dream, even when the odds are stacked against us. Deferred dreams, deterred dreams, destroyed dreams, they can make our hearts feel sick. They can even bring us to a point of questioning God. Why, God? Why am I still single? Why am I stuck in this nowhere job? Why is my church not bigger? Why can't I have kids? Why am I still struggling in my marriage? Why am I battling these health problems? To which God would reply, without minimizing our pain one little bit, he could say to Robert, "You can trust me." Can say every one of you guys here with all of the challenges you faced in life, you can trust me. He says to all of you sitting there in the pew, your dreams aren't working out the way you planned them, but mine are doing just fine. You are mine, and I have a plan for you, and I'm going to make it happen. Will you trust me? Let me wrap this up. I think I've almost to 5 minutes. There's a fascinating phrase in Acts 13:36. Here's what Paul in the New Testament said about David in the Old Testament. For David, after he had served the purpose of God in his own generation, fell asleep and was laid with his fathers. When God finished the dream of David's life, he had permission to die. God has a specific, good, wonderful plan for you and me. He will fulfill that plan if we don't get in his way. My dreams may not come true, but God's dreams for me will. And the good news is, God's dreams are always much better than yours and mine. Always.
He got a prize like twice, and now, oh, okay, enjoy that. Share that with your lovely wife.
Yeah, 10 minutes, not bad. That's a lot better than I thought he's going to do. How would Pat know that? Okay, so next up, Chris Bishop, come on up. Woo-hoo! Welcome. All right. Okay, Chris, now I understand you might be the newest pastor on staff.
A little bit.
Less than a year?
95 days.
There you go. That's pretty new. Okay, so tell us who's in the audience special for you today.
My beautiful bride's in the back corner.
Wait, oh.
You'll probably hear my kid around here someplace. Yeah. I think he's bouncing in the window.
Oh, yeah. There
you go.
Very good.
Okay, we'll have you step
over there, Vanna, and give that wheel a spin.
I am. Go for it. All right, let's give him a hand. Toy Story.
I love this movie. I'll preach on this one.
All right, cool.
You're going to take that one?
Yeah, it's like the only other one that I've actually seen.
I think that was a slam to us, Pat.
No, not at all.
All right, well, go ahead and have a seat.
Let me get my Bible like my pastor did.
Yeah. Okay. And Toy Story's so old, there's been how many? Like three?
It's like 10.
Like 10? Yeah. This is the first one and...
The best one.
Yeah, the first one and the best one. It talks about Woody and Andy. And Buzz Lightyear. Okay. And Buzz Lightyear kind of got a little bit confused thinking he was really the real Buzz Lightyear. And so the movie's a little bit about identity. So I'm going to go ahead and let Pastor Chris go for it.
I'm going to make sure I get my timer here because, you know, five-minute thing, that's a little bit iffy. So identity, I love this story because of a couple reasons. Because I think a lot of times we talk about Woody and his identity things, and he's struggling with his identity. But my favorite character in this is Buzz Lightyear. Favorite character is Buzz Lightyear. Maybe because he was named after Buzz Aldrin, if some of you guys didn't know that. Buzz was a space ranger. He knew he was a space ranger and that he had to protect the galaxy against the evil Zurg. So the reason why I picked this story is growing up, I knew my identity. I knew that I wanted to be an astronaut. Thank you for not laughing. I appreciate that. I knew that I wanted to be an astronaut. I knew so much that I would convince my parents to go on vacations to the Kennedy Space Center. I took all three tours and lived in the gift shop, bought a bunch of books on space. I could quote the Apollo 13 movie. Actually, still my top five. Probably so much that I actually had to buy a new cassette tape, video VCR cassette tape. And I was so into space. Science time would come around and we would talk about space and I would be so into space. I was so into space that I would watch all the documentaries I could. You guys know those documentaries. Star Trek. And that other one that we don't talk much about, Star Wars. You know, I loved it. And that's who I was gonna be. Buzz was convinced that he was gonna be a space ranger. He knew that he had to save the galaxy, and this was just a stop on his own thing. And it wasn't until he had a Buzz Lightyear moment where he got jolted out of that. It wasn't until he got taken out of his comfort zone a little bit and looked up and saw this TV commercial and realized, whoa. He'd had people like, yelling at him, talking to him, yelling at him like, Buzz, you're just a toy. You're a child's plaything. He's like, nope, I'm a space ranger. And it wasn't until he saw that and he realized he had his Buzz Lightyear moment. My Buzz Lightyear moment came sophomore year of high school. I was in geometry class and realized that you actually need to know a lot about math to be an astronaut. Who would have thought? So I had to deal with that. I had to grapple with that. The entirety of what I was at that point in time, I wanted to be an astronaut. You know, Buzz, at this point in time, before he had his Buzz Lightyear moment, he wanted to be, he knew he was a space ranger. His whole life was wrapped up in that. Buzz finally realized his true life's purpose. He realized that he wasn't just a toy. He realized his true life's purpose was to bring joy to Andy. For me, it was about my sophomore year. I realized that my true life's purpose and who my true life's purpose was in. And that allowed me to take risks for God,
to talk to people I wouldn't normally talk to. To talk to teachers I wouldn't normally talk to. And get to tell them my story about Jesus and what God's done for me. So I think the coolest thing about this movie isn't just the identity crisis. It's the risk that they take. The risk that Buzz and Woody takes. You see it at the end of the movie, right? They're falling behind Andy. They know they have to get to Andy to make him to bring joy to him. And Buzz is like, I got this. And they light the rocket that could potentially blow them up. And then that cool line comes up as they're going, Buzz, you're flying. No, I'm falling with style. Because he knew he was on his way to hang out with Andy and bring joy to Andy. It's the same with us. Our identity is in Christ. He's the one that we need to base our lives around. He's the one that should be first. He's the one who is all sufficient. Coming close to my 5 minutes. The Apostle Paul had his Buzz Lightyear moment back in the day when he was Saul, right? He's walking on the road. Buzz Lightyear moment. And his life got changed, tipped upside down. And he had to make a decision. Is he going to risk for Jesus Christ? And he did. He risked his friends, risked his family, risked his job. So I guess I'll leave you with a couple things. Buzz found his true identity and risked everything. So what are we going to do? I'm going to leave you with two questions. First question is, do you know your true identity? Do you know where it's based in? And the second that I want you to think about this week is, what areas in my life do I need to truly risk it all to claim my true identity? So I invite you guys to think about that this week.
Okay, Chris. Monica, thank you.
Thank you, Pastor Chris. Okay, next up, Nick Delgado. Woo! Welcome on stage, Nick.
That is one heck of a spin wheel. Whoever made that, wow.
Yeah, I thought so too.
Yeah.
It kind of keeps going, though. You don't have to spin it very hard. Okay, I bet you have some special folks in the audience today.
You know, the church family and our guests. My family, my personal family will be here next service, but church family and guests, that's the special people here today.
All right, okay, very good. All right, well, let's see how you are spinning this big old wheel. Walk over there with Vanna.
Hello there, girl. Good luck.
All right, let's give this a shot. I brought my Bible since I'm going to be the last one preaching anyway, so.
All right. Oh.
I think I'll keep this one since we want to get our folks out.
Okay. See, he's got... Go for it.
Wait a second.
No. And I know everybody knows about Pretty Woman, so go ahead. Go for it.
Okay, well, I'll see if we can get this done within about 4 minutes. How's that? Well, if you're familiar with the story of Pretty Woman, you don't need to play anymore. It's okay. If you're familiar with the story of Pretty Woman, Richard Gere, what was the other one's name? Julia Roberts, Edward and Vivian, he was a billionaire, she was a prostitute. Well, at some point during the movie, they both wanted to change. He was a ruthless tycoon that just kept taking over businesses, and she lived a life that just wasn't so glamorous, and they both wanted to change. But when it comes to that type of decision, what do you think it took for those two to make that life-changing decision? Was it money? No, because he was a billionaire. and she had her own source of income, unfortunately. Was it prestige? No, it wasn't prestige, because he was one of the most recognized business tycoons in the area. So what was it? What was it that you think helped Edward and Vivian make these changes in their lives to be better people, to be more helpful? Somebody said love, and I agree with that, but it also took that step of faith to initiate that love. So we're going to briefly take a quick look at the original pretty woman, and that is Rahab. She's referred to as Rahab the harlot, a prostitute. And a beautiful story comes into play in the book of Joshua, chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. And I'm not going to read it, but I want you to make a note and look at this story of a life that is transformed. God rewards us with his salvation. When we take a step of faith, he rewards us with his salvation. Even the guiltiest of sinners or lifestyle, taking advantage of people, which really upset Jesus in the Gospels, and also living a lifestyle that was very promiscuous, was not a pleasant, you know, lifestyle to live out as well. But because of their demonstration of faith, they changed their lives. And so you look at the story of Rahab and what transpires. She goes from being a call girl to being converted. She goes from being the last of what people would think about to being the first in line to want to know God. She wasn't reformed or conformed, but she was transformed. And there's a beautiful passage in, I say beautiful because it just goes to show you the impact that her step of faith took in Matthew 1:5, because it demonstrates her lineage to Jesus. And again, you can just make that note for later. The story's told like this, and I'm just going to go through these 21 verses in about 30 seconds. Rahab was a notorious sinner in a condemned city, the city of Jericho. Not good people. Read the story and you'll see why. Rahab had a great fear of judgment. She had heard what was going to take place. God was going to use Joshua to come in and destroy the city. She believed the report of God's greatness. She had heard about what God did with Moses, you know, parting the Red Sea and overcoming some huge kings over some powerful cities back in that time. She pleaded for God's mercy and shows incredible faith. Remember, she doesn't know much about this God of the Jews. So it took that step of faith. Her household safety is confirmed in verses 19 and 20. After saying, hey, listen, if you could just do this. And the two spies that Joshua sent into the city to check it out says, hey, we'll make sure you're taken care of. Just do what we've asked you to do. She demonstrates her faith. God has a way of working through very ordinary and very unlikely people. He can save and use any one of us if we make ourselves available. What's really cool is he didn't give her a scarlet letter, but he gave her a scarlet thread, if you see the passage. You know, it's really interesting. I can just imagine what would have played out when those two spies went back home, and as a loving wife would normally do, hey, so honey, how was your day? Well, we kind of got saved by this prostitute. And you can just imagine how the rest of that story went on. God used Rahab. But here's what's interesting. She had three strikes against her. And I'm going to close with this. One, she was a Canaanite, part of an evil group of people. So evil that God used the Jews to demonstrate his judgment against them. That's how bad these people were. Strike two, in this day and age, in this time of history, she was a woman. Women were treated as second-class citizens. They weren't given much value, sad to say. They were treated as property, yet God worked through her. That's the power of a loving God, that grace that Tim was singing about earlier. Strike three, she was a prostitute. She sold herself for money. But God sees the potential in every single person, no matter what our past. There's a couple references in the New Testament, in Hebrews and James, that mentions the incredible faith that Rahab demonstrated in her life, by simply saying, hey, I'll do this. I've heard of your God. I don't know much about him, but I'm going to take this step of faith. You know, Robert was talking about that ouch. She lived a horrible life of ouch as a prostitute. Her ouch was having no self-worth. But she took that simple step of faith that so many of us have done, but maybe there's someone here that haven't done it. All it takes is a simple step. Rahab had all that was going against her, and yet she had one great redeeming factor in her, and that was faith. She believed God. That's it.
Okay, thank you, Nick. All right, you guys will recall that Gene passed on the first spin.
Yeah, so and there's only one movie left, so Gene, you're kind of stuck. There's no more passing.
Preach it.
Come on up.
Preach it.
It's a winner run through it. You might want to pick. We'll let you spin and see if you can win a prize, but you know you're going to have to preach this.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I know, mate, and if you get the cigars, I don't know what happens, because I think Tim took all of them.
He took all of them?
Yeah.
No.
Oh, maybe one left? Oh!
Get it out.
Now, A River Runs Through It had Brad Pitt. Do you remember this movie? A long time. And Robert Redford, who's my favorite.
Bobby
Patello. Yeah. Uh-oh. He directed it. So, Gene, take it away. You're taking us home.
Okay. I love the movie A River Runs Through It because it's filmed in the same state that gave me my bride, the state of Montana, and it's a marvelous story of fishing. But the movie A River Runs Through It is really an allegory of Cain and Abel in the book of Genesis, two brothers. Their story unfolds in the fourth chapter of the book of Genesis, and both Cain and Abel were sons of Adam, who God clothed in the righteousness of the shedding of the blood of an innocent animal. The first picture in Scripture of the shed blood of Jesus Christ. God shed blood in order to provide a covering, a temporary covering for sin in the life of Adam. One of the sons, Cain, the Bible tells us, presented an offering to God based on his own works and his own merit, while the other son, Abel, offered an offering to God based on faith. And in the movie A River Runs Through It, we see the type of Cain and Abel portrayed by the two sons of a righteous Presbyterian minister who raised his sons on the foundation of godly truth. One of the sons in the movie lived a life of faith and obedience, while the other son lived a life of self-destruction and rebellion. One son lived, the other son died. Sadly, it is a story too often repeated, and sometimes in our own lives, and sometimes in the lives of those we know and those we love. At the conclusion of the movie, the only son, the son of faith, is seen fishing. By now, most people turn the movie off and miss the best part of the film. The one son, the son of faith, is seen fishing alone on the Blackfoot River. Age has taken its toll on him, and as he casts his fly with a four-count rhythm, he remembers all those who have gone before him. And the movie concludes with this poetical phrase: eventually, all things merge into one, and a river runs through it. The river was cut by the world's great floods and runs over the rocks from the basement of time. On some of the rocks are timeless raindrops. Under the rocks are the words. Some of the words are theirs. And then this final line: I am haunted by waters. By now, most people turn the movie off and have absolutely no idea what that's all about. Let me tell you what I think it's all about. Philippians 2:10 tells us that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. This is a picture of the line of the poem: eventually, all things merge into one. Jesus is the river that flows through all of it. In Revelation 22:1, we read, "Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb. John said, "Behold the Lamb, behold the river, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." The poem goes on to say that the river was cut by the world's great flood. By looking at the big picture, we find that the flood account is a clear model revealing God's plan for the world, and that plan is Jesus. The biblical flood story ultimately is about Jesus. The poem continues, "The river, who is Jesus, runs over the rocks from the basement of time." The rocks are people. The basement of time is creation. Going on some of the rocks are timeless raindrops. Under the rocks are the words. Some of the words are theirs. The timeless raindrops is the truth of God's word, the Bible. Some of the rocks, people, respond to the truth of God's word, and some do not. And then the concluding line of the movie, "I am haunted by waters." This is the message of the gospel to those who reject Jesus, the living water. He is a stumbling block. But to those who accept, he is the power of God. The one who rejects Jesus becomes the river of judgment, and his haunting is one of distress and of worry. But to the one who accepts Jesus, the river of life, his haunting is one of the continuous presence and abiding love of God. I am haunted by waters.
Okay, gee.
You get another prize. Very cool.
All right, as you all know, there's another pastor of the church that's not here today. And that's Gil Hernandez. He's on a mission in Mexico. So he's the pastor, the missions pastor. So I just want you all to know that he will be getting a prize. And we certainly want to mention his name and recognize him as one of the pastoral staff of the church today. So, you guys did fantastic. Thank you so much. I hope you all enjoyed it. That just about wraps things up for Van and I. We want to thank you for having us up to Clovis. We're going to take off and head back to Culver City now, and hopefully we can get through the grapevine and all the mud and all that. But we've had a blast, and you guys have a great day.